So these are some notes from last time. We got the equations of motion in the circular restricted three-body problem and in non-dimensional units. And for now on, I'm going to be using, instead of tau for the non-dimensional time, I'm just going to use t, okay? So when I do an over dot, that means derivative with respect to this non-dimensional time. I'm writing the effective potential as u bar, and then the little subscript just means partial derivative with respect to that variable. So I'll probably start using some of this, you know, quicker notation just to write things a little faster. Also, instead of writing 1 minus mu, I'll use mu 1. So mu 1 is like the non-dimensional mass for the larger primary, and mu 2 is just mu, and that's the non-dimensional mass of the second primary. Effectively, we've said that the sum of the two primary masses is equal to 1, or that's the unit of mass. That, along with the unit of time and the unit of distance we've chosen, effectively makes the gravitational constant equal to 1 in these units. So that's why G will not show up. And if you ever are concerned about, well, how do I scale back? It's great that we've got these non-dimensional units. How do I scale back to the usual units? You multiply lengths by the semi-major axis of the primaries and the time. This non-dimensional time, you would multiply it by the period over 2 pi. And we actually put that in our book for a few examples. So this is saying that the conversion from the primed dimensionalized system, if you want the dimensionalized, that's the left-hand side of this equation up here. The non-dimensional is the unprimed. So if you have, we've got a length scale L, and then the time scale T, capital T over 2 pi, and then the velocity you can just get from those two. So you would scale things. This is just for an example, some example systems like in the Sun-Jupiter system or Sun-Earth-Moon. Often when Sun-Earth-Lagrange points and three-body system is discussed, the Earth and Moon are grouped together as one mass. And so that's where you might see slightly different values of mu if someone forgot to put in the moon. It'll be about 1% different. But that's what we have there. And then the length scale there is about 1 AU. I'm looking like right there. And then we've got the capital T, actually in seconds. I don't know if you've learned this trick, but a year in seconds is about pi times 10 to the seventh. And then we've got the Earth, Moon, and others. So you would, everything you do in the non-dimensional system, you just multiply the appropriate thing, whether it's a length or a velocity or time. This is like page 25 of the book. It's early on. That's the equations of motion. Today, I had a goal to go over energy and the Jacobi integral, how it relates to the realms of possible motion and the equilibrium points. Probably won't get to all of those, but we'll see. So this is where we ended last time. We had derived the equations of motion using the Newtonian approach and then the Lagrangian approach. The nice thing about the Lagrangian approach is that there is a well-known constant of motion for all Lagrangian systems, and it's called the Jacobi integral. And historically, it's also been called that for the three-body problem for centuries. For any Lagrangian system with generalized coordinates, Qi, where I goes from 1 to n, this is what you get for the Jacobi constant. It's a constant if your Lagrangian doesn't explicitly depend on time, which ours does not because we went into the rotating frame. So the big advantage of going into the rotating frame is this constant of motion. The price you pay is that it's a little harder to interpret what orbits are doing because it definitely does not look like the usual Keplerian orbits. Just to give you an example of that, the thing that got me started on this was some initial work on comet motion. And there was a comet called Oterma that did some interesting things when it passed by Jupiter. So I think I've got a video here. On the left, this is showing the inertial frame. And on the right, this is the rotating frame. Forget about the green trajectory for now. Just look at the red one. So we've got the sun in the middle. And on the left, you'll see Jupiter going around in its orbit, the black dot. On the right, Jupiter is on the x-axis where all that business seems to be happening. And let me just play this. So on the left, the orbits look like usual Keplerian orbits. Then we had a pass by Jupiter. It's another Keplerian orbit inside. And then and it goes back out. This was just over a 70-year period from 1910 to 1980. So again, just looking at the left side of the inertial frame. So we're on a large orbit outside Jupiter. Now we're on an orbit inside Jupiter. This thing does three circuits and then it catches back up with Jupiter and is now on an orbit very similar to its previous orbit, but you could see that it's changed its phase. It's rotated its argument of perihelion. On the right-hand side, you see some other things about what's going on. The comet gets close to Jupiter, and then it's inside this region around Jupiter, and then it's going back out. So it went through what looks like a bottleneck around Jupiter. The sort of thin C shape that we have there, that's related to the Jacobi integral. The comet has a certain value of this integral just based on its initial condition. And according to theory, it cannot pass through that C shape. So that's called a forbidden region, or it's just unreachable. It just doesn't have the right amount of Jacobi constant. I want to say energy, but then people think of mechanical energy, and it's slightly different from that. The Jacobi constant isn't exactly equal to the mechanical energy, meaning kinetic plus potential. It just doesn't. It equals something else, and we can talk about that.
Dr. Ross, I have a quick question.
Yeah.
What are the units on the Jacobi integral, or is this unitless?
If you put it in dimensional form, it would have the same units as energy.
Okay, but don't think about it as like we think about other stuff. Okay.
Yeah, don't think of it as kinetic plus potential energy, but it does have units of energy. For any general Lagrangian system, the Lagrangian function has units of energy. And so this thing called a little h, the Jacobi constant, also has units of energy. For the circular restricted three body problem, I wrote something incorrect last time. H equals this. It's actually one half the velocity squared, but it's the velocity seen in the rotating frame plus this effective potential. Remember the effective potential? It was the gravity potential. I guess we had it up here. The gravitational potential part, and then a part that takes into account some rotation effects due to the rotating frame, so the centrifugal force. And then there's this constant that gets put in just by convention. So if you set z equal to zero, so then we're looking at just the planar problem, and we're to plot the effective potential, it looks like this. So you've got what looks like a giant caldera and then a smaller caldera, and then it just sort of falls off as you get further away from both of the bodies. And it's the critical points here, critical points of this surface. Just view this as a height function, and it's got some points where the slope vanishes in both directions. Those are the Lagrange points, but we'll say more about that a little later. I want to talk about how to interpret the Jacobi constant or Jacobi integral. Before that, I want to go through the third and final way that you can derive the equations of motion, and that's the Hamiltonian way. It's very similar to the Lagrangian way. Let me bring that up over here. Okay, so this is the Hamiltonian approach to deriving the equations of motion. Sometimes you could just start from scratch, but often the way that one goes is you start with the Lagrangian. So if you have a Lagrangian, which we do, and in general, the Lagrangian function will be a function of the coordinates and time rates of change of coordinates, generalized coordinates. You do something that's called the Legendre transformation. And I have another video on that if you're interested. It's just another way to change coordinates. It's been used in things like statistical mechanics. But the Legendre transformation, instead of using velocities, these are velocities that should be q1 dot through qn dot. Instead of using velocities, you used momenta. And so you define something called the generalized momenta. So the generalized momenta are, we'll call it p sub I. And you just get it from taking the partial derivative of L with respect to qi dot. And you do that for all of the coordinates. So I goes from 1 to n. But then you want to write a new function called the Hamiltonian function. It's going to be a function of the coordinates, q1 through qn, and these momenta instead of the velocities. So this set of n equations here should be invertible so that you can write each of these q1, dot, Q2 dot, all the way up to Qn dot in terms of momenta. And then you write the Hamiltonian function. And so the prescription for writing the Hamiltonian function is you've got H. So H will be function of Q1 through Qn, but also now P1 through Pn. It looks a lot like the Jacobi integral because we're writing a sum from 1 to n, pi qi dot minus l. You write the qi dots in terms of the pi's and the qi's. So we could do that for our system and get the generalized momenta. So for the CR3BP, what do we get? We'll write px because our generalized coordinates are x, y, and z. And then we've got x dot, y dot, z dot on the Lagrangian side. So the momentum, there's terminology related to this. This is called the momentum conjugate to the x variable. Remember what x was? That's the location of the particle in the rotating frame. And this will be partial L partial x dot. And from what we had for L, this becomes x dot minus y. The momentum conjugate to y is partial L partial y dot. And given what we had, that's x plus y dot, or y dot plus x, however you want to view it. Z is pretty easy, partial L partial z dot. It's just z dot. So you can't think of this momentum the way we usually think of mechanical momentum, right? And mechanical momentum in the x direction in an inertial frame is just going to be mass times that velocity. Here we get these weird other terms because we're in a rotating frame. So it takes some getting used to it at first, but that's just how it is. So then we define the Hamiltonian function. So the Hamiltonian is going to be px x dot plus py y dot plus pz times z dot minus the Lagrangian. But then we write everything in terms of just x, y, and z, and the momentum's px, py, pz. What you end up getting, you get 1/2, I'll put a square bracket, px plus y squared, that whole quantity squared, plus py minus x quantity squared, plus pz squared, plus the effective potential, which is a function of x, y, and z. So that's our Hamiltonian. And then Hamilton's equations in general, they are qi dot equals partial h partial pi. And then the way that that momentum evolves is pi dot equals negative partial h partial qi. And so we have this for each pair. So there's actually 2n first order ODEs that result from this. Into first order ODEs, the Hamilton's equations automatically give you first order ODEs. So that's nice. Again, if we do this now for the CR3VP, we'll get x dot equals partial h partial px, and that's equal to px plus y. The only dependence on px, right, is this first term here. The only dependence on py is there, and the only dependence on pz is there. The dependence on x, y, and z, or particularly x and y, is going to be a little bit complicated because they show up in a couple different places. So that's x dot. Y dot is partial h, partial py, and that is py minus x. Z dot is partial h, partial pz, and it is just pz. What about px dot? Px dot is negative partial h, partial x. And if you work out what that is, this is, strangely, we have a momentum showing up. So this is py minus x minus the effective potential, partial the effective potential with respect to x. So I'm just writing that in shorthand form as subscript x. We do py dot. It's the same thing, same procedure, partial h, partial y. And this equals negative px minus y minus u bar. And I don't want to give short shrift to z. Let me put it here. Pz dot is negative partial h partial z, but that only shows up in the potential energy. So, this should be a sub y. This is minus u sub z. A bunch of partial derivatives of that effective potential energy. So these end up being the same. So you could view the system as being in a space of either x, y, z, x dot y dot z dot, or x, y, z, p, x, p, y, p, z. We'll sort of go between the two as needed, but they are the same. I guess we should say they are equivalent because we are using different variables. Another nice thing about the Hamiltonian in general, if the Hamiltonian doesn't depend explicitly on time, so if you have partial h, partial t equals zero, then that means that h as a function throughout the motion is constant. And we also have that because our h doesn't depend explicitly on time. None of these things depend on time. So what we have here is h will be a constant. And it's like the Jacobi integral, but written in terms of momentum instead of those rotating frame velocities. So that is a constant. All right. So now let's talk about what that constant means.
If you appreciated this video, please like and subscribe, or just wait and watch the next video in the series.
All right.